We're delighted that you came, and it seemed like perhaps you should know a little bit about how the show came together, because it was not premised on great collectors are collecting. When the Forum of Curators, Conservators, and Scientists at the museum learned there was an opportunity to honor Philippe as he retires, although he does not allow that word, with an exhibition, we had just 6 months, and in what Keith has called a democratic exhibition, we ask all the members of the curators and conservators what they thought were the most important works that were acquired during Philippe's tenure, and sorting that group out with the works that Philippe himself had remarked on in the recent acquisitions bulletins. Our department heads, either in groups with their staff or in other ways, gave to me a list of the works they would wish to see in these galleries. So these are not selected for any thematic purpose, but are a great celebration of what came into the museum. And then after we got it up, and Jeff Daly, the designer, had the particularly brilliant idea, because Philippe wanted non-art historical compelling juxtapositions, that the simplest solution to that was, in fact, to put them in our pattern of acquisition, because there is nothing logical in terms of what comes on the market in a given year. We have this installation that takes you through the history of collecting at the Met and amazes me constantly that the countries represented in Gallery 1 are the countries that are represented in Gallery 8. Africa and Africa, Europe and Europe. We started Philippe's career with an encyclopedic taste and ended it in terms of this exhibition in the same way. But threading through that, which is something that I've become quite interested in, is a very great Americanness. So a portrait of Elijah Boardman, who goes with the beginning of an establishment of a visual voice for this country, is echoed in the Paul Revere urn in the Townsend chest toward the end, and extends forward in the mid-19th century taste of the photograph of Yosemite, that is this romantic view, from my point of view, Malcolm may disagree, of the expansionist ability of America to move forward, that is echoed in the autograph quilt, and then moves into what is increasingly a really American statement that the world responds to, Georgia O'Keeffe, portrait by Stieglitz, Walker Evans, Avedon, these photographs that echo around the world that are often given by artists in their states are acquired through the generosity of artists, collectors en masse, as Philippe got the Jasper Johns for us, the Pollock that came through the Newman gift, the Rauschenberg, so that one could just sort out the pieces that are specifically American provenance and have from this show a history of American collecting that wasn't the type of collector Inga's talking about that only does American, because people collected these for very disparate reasons, but they come together in a whole. And then there is another aspect of America that I am quite fascinated by that's a much lower key, and I hope you will kind of look for it as we go through the galleries, and that is how the Americas funded the taste that Keith represents in European paintings in Everett. So I have been quite enchanted thinking about the Rubens and the American painting on this wall behind me, because this is America trying to reach to England. Books that are European on display, the little excise stamp from Britain. And this, the Rubens in turn, has just one reference to the Americas, and it's the bird in the upper right corner. The wealth of the Americas that makes Spain so powerful that Rubens can be its great ambassador, its great painter, and just before he marries Helen, he is in Spain and working on diplomatic missions. And if you compare this, it's not an actual logical comparison, it's just one I like, right around the corner to what Catherine will be talking about, the Juan de Flan. It's a picture that comes to Spain with Isabel of Castile, with the moment that Columbus is finding the New World, when this wealth that will come in gold and other means from Latin America is beginning to flow into Europe. And in another gallery, we have a set of Sèvres with the making of cocoa and hot chocolate, another of these new things that makes Europe wealthy. And we have several pieces of gold in the show from pre-Columbian world that is part of the wealth that builds the European collections so that you see how America without influencing the art helps fund the arts with raw materials, not great production. And you see in The Natchez by Delacroix a romantic vision of America from about the 1830s, the same time as the China, that I think is a remarkable response to the slightly later photograph of Yosemite in the same gallery. It's that type of ability to put together visions of what you want from individual collectors, from collectors who have been generous to the museum in helping to get something that is beyond the resources of an individual today, that we celebrate here. And we are going to do it with remarks from Philippe first and then a series of some of our most distinguished curators. And we're hoping to allow you to sit down a whole lot. So when Philippe has spoken, he will introduce Mike Hearn, who is going to talk about one of our earliest supporters, Douglas Dillon. And then Everett will talk on Mrs. Reitzman, and then we will be moving into the next gallery. So Philippe, the whole purpose of the exhibition.